Do you want your Survivor games to go from this to this? Well, you came to the right video. Hey, my name is Notbread, and today I'm here to teach you on how to counter the Blight. But Notbread, aren't you a Blight man? Why are you making this video? Well, yes, little Dwight, I don't know how you got in this video. I'm currently top 300 on the Blight leaderboards, and I absolutely love this character. But I noticed that a lot of the community doesn't quite feel the same way. A lot of the player base, both including new and experienced players, can struggle a lot against the Blight as he is different from every other killer in the game. I want to quickly put in a disclaimer that all this information can't be applied easily overnight, as it takes a lot of experience to understand the Blight. But this will help push you in the right direction. Now, with that out of the way, there are timestamps below if you want to skip to a certain portion of the video and a Google document of everything I mentioned down throughout the video. Let's get started. Starting off with Blight's base kit. Blight's power is our token-based system where he can consume one token to perform a rush. After a Blight bumps into an object, he is able to rush again. He has five tokens, so he has five rushes. His first rush, though, he cannot injure you with. He has to bump first, and then he can start injuring people with his consecutive rushes. After the Blight goes into fatigue, whether it's from hitting you or from using all of his rushes, his recharge time depends on how many rushes he has used. It takes 2 seconds for every token used base kit. So let's say a Blight has used 4 rushes, it's going to take 8 seconds for his power to get back after fatigue. It's really important to understand how many rushes the Blight has left, so you know that you can duck around a few corners and be safe, or if you're able to make it to a pallet or a window. And understanding that once he goes into fatigue, Blight will be a normal M1 killer for that short amount of time, which is when Blight is at his weakest. When a Blight goes into fatigue by either bumping or swinging, his recharge time doesn't start until the fatigue animation is over. However, if a Blight breaks a pallet during his rushes, the recharge starts instantly, so do keep that in mind when you are kind of gauging how long you have until the Blight has to rush again. Now going into his add-ons, I don't mention every single add-on that the Blight has, but he still has quite a few that are really powerful and the ones that you'll probably end up seeing the most. First, we're going to be talking about add-ons that change Blight's rush count and his recharge time. Starting off with the Adrenaline Vial, this gives the Blight 2 extra rushes, so 7 total, and his recharge goes from 2 seconds per token to 1 second per token. This means after using 7 rushes, the Blight will get his power back in 7 seconds. Shredded Notes makes the Blight lose 1 rush, so he has 4 total, with a third of a second taken off for each token recharge, 1 2/3 total. With 4 rushes, Blight's power will come back in less than 7 seconds. If you combine this with Adrenaline Vial, it will be 6 rushes with a 4 second recharge time. Figuring out how many rushes a Blight has in a chase is super important. If you notice that the Blight has anything but 5 rushes, you can see that they're running at least one of these add-ons. Whenever I'm facing a Blight, I have 2 different mindsets. The first one is playing around pallets and trying to force the Blight into fatigue, which we will discuss later. The second one is after the Blight fatigue, where he is now out of his power. This is where I try to calculate in my head Blight's recharge time and use that to gauge if I'm able to leave the loop and safely make it to another tile. If not, I know that I have to stay in the current loop and just keep playing like an M1 killer until he gets his power back. Knowing when to run away from a loop compared to when to actually stay at the loop is really important against the Blight, because his power is all set on preventing you from holding W. And if you know that he doesn't have his power, that is the perfect time to hold W. Now talking about Alchemist Ring. After hitting any lethal rush, you instantly regain all your rush tokens after fatigue. So if you notice that a Blight rushes immediately after hitting you, you can assume he's running this add-on. Make sure you are always pathing towards the closest pallet or window to make sure that you have a chance of not getting downed really fast. Alright, now going to another category of Blight's add-ons is speed. Blight's base kit rush speed is 230%, which is double of a normal killer's movement. And then he has add-ons such as Blighted Crow and Rat, which after each consecutive rush, the Blight gains movement speed. And then there's the Adrenaline Vial, which was mentioned earlier, which is also a 10% flat increase movement speed. The speed add-ons, for me at least, they are pretty easy to notice. If you notice the Blight is becoming faster after each rush, you can assume he's running at least one of these add-ons. Usually most Blights like to run both Blighted Crow and Rat. There's not like a super helpful tip that I can provide against these add-ons since they don't change how much you play against the Blight. However, you do have to keep in mind when he has these add-ons, he has more map pressure since he can get from point A to point B a lot faster. And since he has increased movement speed on his rushes, he can rush further before going into fatigue. And what this means in Chase 2 is that since he's faster, it's going to be a lot harder for you to react to his movement. So make sure you be quick and don't get caught out. Alright, now going into his slam duration add-ons, which are probably the add-ons that you'll probably see the least in this list. Rose Tonic and Pistola Dust both increase the slam duration, and then they also increase the movement speed while in your slam, while in the Blight slam duration, which I don't know the numbers of exactly. Again, you don't have to worry about too much about these add-ons, but it's really important to keep them in mind, especially if you have a perk like Deadheart. Slam duration can be super helpful for Blights when they're trying to get around a corner that they don't want to use an extra bump, or if they're trying to squeeze through a doorway in a building. So just because you're inside of a building doesn't mean you're exactly safe yet, so do keep that in mind. Okay, now these are add-ons that kind of are just in a throwaway category because they all have very unique effects. Starting off with Compound 21, if the Blight bumps within 8 meters of you, they can see your aura for 3.5 seconds. How do you play around this? Well, this add-on can be very hard to notice. With a perk like Distortion or Object of Obsession, it is really easy to call out this add-on. However, if you aren't running these perks, it's extremely hard to tell. If you're hiding, the Blight finds you really fast during his rushes, or if he is constantly tracking you through tiles with little to no LOS, he's probably running this add-on. Again, it can be really hard to notice, and this kind of add-on, in order to notice, it takes a lot of game experience. But usually when you are going against another player, you can kind of tell if they are able to see you or not. The best way to counterplay this add-on is to play around pallets that has lots of LOS or line of sight, which he's still going to be able to see you, but at least you are able to see him, and you actually have a chance to react to his movement. If you are forced to play a jungle gym, make sure you stay near the pallet though so that you can attempt to force him out of his power. And then we have Iridescent Blight Tag. When the Blight uses all of his rush tokens, the last rush will put the survivor into the dying state. Thankfully, this add-on compared to Compound 21 is a lot more easy to notice. If you see a Blight instantly down somebody at any given time, you can assume that this add-on is in play, because exposed perks don't work in his power, so most Blights do not usually run exposed perks. This is where rush counting becomes the most important. You have to know when Blight is in his last rush, so if you need to go for a last second dodge, or if you are able to use a lot of LOS blockers and tight corners to dodge the hits. Thankfully, most of the time, a Blight will run this add-on with either like Crow or Ring, so they will always have 5 rushes. Sometimes you might see them with Shredded Notes, but for the most part, Blights would rather add speed or another really strong add-on with this, with the Iridescent Tag. Lastly, we have Compound 33. This add-on will give you the hindered effect for 3% for 3 seconds when the Blight bumps within 16 meters of you. And the Blight is also able to instantly break a pallet without swinging and during a shorter cooldown of 1.5 seconds instead of the normal 2.5. Again, it is extremely easy to notice, but unfortunately this add-on, you don't have much to work with. When you are hindered by this add-on, not only do you get the status effect on the right side of your screen, but the survivor model starts dripping orangey blighted goo. Blight's one true weakness is pallets. That's the only time where you can prevent a Blight from hitting you. But with this add-on, he truly has very little to worry about. You can use pallets as a last resort to buy as much time as possible. you most likely injure you though right before, unless there's another pallet close by. However, your best bet again is to use small areas with tons of corners to dodge his hit, and to stay as far away from possible from your teammates so they can work on Jhin safely. This add-on is often paired with Adrenaline Vial, which after breaking the pallet, the Blight's recharges so fast that he can rush immediately after the break animation. Very fun and an interactive behavior. Good add-on concept. Yeah, no, sorry. Unfortunately, there's not too much you can do about this add-on. You can try relying on windows, but windows are usually a lot weaker against the Blight compared to pallets. With this add-on, if you do need to use pallets, you will chew through your resources very quickly. Okay, for this part of the video, I'm going to be talking about the different skill levels of a Blight player, which I decided to put in three categories just to be as simple as possible. We have the beginner Blight, a Blight that likes to go for clips, and a Blight who is playing as efficiently as possible, which we're going to refer to as a competitive or comp Blight. The reason these categories are being made is because the survivor's counterplay against a Blight heavily depends on the skill of the player.
Life could be a dream, life could be a dream. Do, 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 sa-boom. Life could be a dream, sa-boom. If I could take you up in paradise up above. Sa-boom. If you would tell me I'm the only one that you love. Life could be a dream, sweetheart, hello, hello again.
Starting off with the beginner Blights, this category is for players that don't utilize Blight's power for well. They will often use their power strictly for mobility only and will rarely attempt to use their power in chase. These are obviously the easiest Blights to go against. Since they don't use their power often in chase, you can loop them as a normal M1 killer. Do be careful of trying to chain tiles together, since that leaves a window of you being in the open, making it really easy to hit. So make sure you're only chaining tiles when he's in fatigue. If a Blight does try to use his power in a loop and seems to be struggling to get around the loop, make sure to hug it as tight as possible and you'll end up being faster at getting around the object that he will be. If you get caught out with no pallets or windows nearby, even a small rock or tree to break line of sight can make it very difficult for a Blight to hit you. This, in my opinion, is the most fun and interesting Blight to go against. What can make these kinds of Blights really hard to go against for newer players who do not play Blight is not understanding all the different types of techs. Before going into each Blight tech, I want to clearly mention flaring. Going around the corner of an object gives the survivor an opportunity to flare, where you kind of make a U-shape with your movement if you're expecting a Blight to flick around a corner. This is really helpful in a lot of situations, such as if you know the Blight has only one rush left and he has to commit to a flick, or if you're just expecting a flick to happen. Flaring is also possible to do in the open by fake turning in one direction and then going the other way. This, however, will rarely work on a good Blight, and your best bet is to keep objects between him and you. But it's always nice to keep this in mind. Now we're going to go into the different Blight techs that you need to worry about. The first one is the hug tech, where after a bump, the Blight will use his slam duration to walk up to an object, such as a car or a rock. After this, they will look down or up, which will allow them to rush again, letting them slide around the object. Since for this tech, the Blight isn't looking directly at you, it is possible to leave the loop. This can throw a lot of Blights off guard and they end up swinging before they realize that you are gone. Be careful if the Blight is using Compound 21, since it will be a lot easier to notice if you leave the loop. And if you do this to the same Blight over and over again, they will end up not swinging and they will just bump into something and convert it to a hit. You can also attempt to predict which direction a Blight is going to around the corner and attempt to hug the tile super tight. My little tell on this is that if they are on the left side of an object, they will hug along the right side and go around that corner and vice versa. Also, be careful if the Blight is running any speed add-ons, since this will make it a whole lot harder and will rely on you to try and flare the Blight instead. This is the simplest form of hug teching with lots of variations, so we're going to go into the next techs that are very similar to the hug tech, such as the virtual tech or the B1 tech. This allows the Blight to slide around an object to get a hit. What makes this tech different, however, is how it started. A Blight will walk up to an object and then they will back up slowly until their notification to rush shows up and they start spamming their rush button. This will allow the first rush to instantly bump and launch into a lethal rush and start sliding around the corner. This tech can be very hard to react to since it's as if the Blight's first rush is a lethal rush. With speed, again, this makes it a whole lot harder and you have to rely on flaring or leaving the loop. When you see a Blight just standing at a pallet or a loop looking down, they're trying to line up the V1 and aren't paying too much attention to you. So again, leaving the loop is probably your best option. Also, watch out since some Blights are able to pull off a V1 instantly without needing to line up anything, which is what we call a walking V1 or a walking virtual. And now we have the Moon Rush. Again, extremely similar to the last two techs mentioned, the Moon Rush allows the Blight to slide across an object around a corner. What this makes this tech different, however, is the movement during the slide. If the Blight flicks his camera while sliding, it will look as if he is rushing backwards. A lot of things can happen during a Moon Rush, which depends on how hard the Blight is flicking his camera. Most of the time, the Blight will keep going in the same direction, but they will round the corner and are already facing in your direction, which can make pulling a 90 degree or 180 degree flick a lot easier. However, if the Blight flicks his camera hard enough while sliding, he will end up slingshotting back in the direction that he is facing and continuing the rush that way. There's no guaranteed way to predict which direction the Blight is going, but if you notice the Blight slowing down during his slide, that's a pretty good tell that he's probably trying to change directions. Another thing to keep in mind, if the Blight is running Adrenaline Vial, since this add-on reduces Blight's rush turn rates, it is nearly impossible to flick their camera enough to slingshot in the other direction. This tech can be a little hard to flare since throughout the slide, they can see you pretty easily. Your best bet is to go really wide when looping and even leaving if necessary. This works really well because the Blight is using most of his rush to slide across the object. And when he goes around the corner, he's kind of forced to swing because he's not going to be able to bump into anything. Alright, next we're going into the competitive Blights, or there's the comp Blights. This category is for players who play Blights very efficiently. They often don't go for the flashy techs mentioned previously, and they just try to down you as quickly as possible. These players are extremely comfortable with using their power inside the loops and are extremely quick with it. These Blights can often be the hardest ones to face against, as when played at the highest level, Blight is very unique and its counterplay is different from most other killers. Before talking about how to play against him, I want to quickly explain some terms that I'm going to be mentioning a lot throughout this section. We're first going to be talking about pallet priority, which just goes for both the killer and the survivor. This basically means whoever is closer to the pallet has advantage over the loop. Having advantage means that you're more likely to either hit the survivor or drop the pallet, depending on which side you're playing. Bump logic. For Blight, this basically means how fast you can go from point A to point B with the least amount of rushes possible. Any object within the loop or any that are nearby can be used to bump off of. Take note of all trees, boxes, rocks, and other objects that the Blight might be able to use. Resources, this is mainly talking about windows and pallets that you have around the map, as well as any other structure to help you prevent or prolong the hit. And then we're going to be talking about forcing fatigue. Pretty straightforward, but you do this by either making the Blight exhaust all of his rushes or have him breaking a pallet mid-rush. These kinds of Blights can be really frustrating to face since everyone will be going down really fast and it's incredibly hard to last and chase. It's really important to be prepared to go against these Blights really early on. One major factor that can help you last longer in chase is to make sure that you have pallet priority from the Blight. If a really good Blight has pallet priority, the only way that you won't get hit is if the Blight messes up his bump logic. This will end up requiring you to drop the pallet pretty early in the chase, which can burn through a lot of your resources. Once the pallet is dropped, do not leave immediately until you see what the Blight is doing. If they instantly break the pallet, you can move on to the next loop and repeat the process again. However, if they decide to play around the pallet while the pallet is still dropped, you are kind of forced to play that loop still. even if the pallet is dropped, pallet priority is still effective in this situation. If you try to go around the loop, a blight can use bump logic and still be able to hit you at the pallet in most situations. Instead, your best bet is to camp the dropped pallet and get ready to spam vault it. A pallet's hitbox is really big, and a lot of the time a blight will vacuum into the pallet, breaking it instead of hitting you, forcing him into fatigue. Try to gauge how much time you have to make it to a new loop by how many rushes he has used. Okay, so this one's pretty obvious, but not only do you need to play super safe during your chases against these kind of blights, you also, for your best chance of winning, is to make sure you're as efficient on gens as possible. The first chase needs to be prolonged as long as possible to get early gens done quickly. Lots of these blights like to run strong gen slowdown perks, and some of the stronger perks for blight are ones that involve downing people, such as Pain Res or Pop Goes the Weasel. If there are no survivors incapacitated, however, such as hooked, downed, or dead, it can be really hard for a blight to keep control of his gens. It's really important to chase the blight away from your teammates working on gens, as it forces them to choose between getting the down or leaving to prevent the gen from popping. This can be really difficult when survivors play in solo queue, but try to keep in mind of your teammates' positions so they aren't caught out in the open. And if you notice a survivor is getting chased into your direction, don't be afraid to leave early and rotate to a different gen, as this allows a survivor to use resources in that area without endangering yourself. Stay separated from your teammates. Since Blight has incredible chase power with a relatively short cooldown, he can snowball incredibly easily if he knows the location of more than one survivor. Now we're going to go into some advanced survivor tips when it comes to your looping against the blight. Starting off with the crouch check, if the blight is at a higher elevation from you, for example, hills, stairs, and doorways to some buildings such as shack, you will be able to crouch and duck underneath the blight's hitbox and dodge the hit. Be careful, because if the blight is expecting this, they can bump close to you and hit you with the beginning of the rush, which has a larger hitbox. Another form of crouch checking can be done next to a dropped pallet. Since the pallet hitbox is significantly bigger than yours, if the blight flicks in your direction, they will most of the time be redirected into the pallet. This is also very helpful to force the blight into fatigue. Pluto attacking. Blight's first rush isn't considered a lethal rush, which means they aren't able to hit you until they bump for the first time. With this knowledge, we can use our own survivor's hitbox, which the blight cannot bump off of, and attempt to get him sandwiched between yourself and another object. This only really works on some tiles, such as the slippery cars on Autohaven and Macmillan, and most of the shacks on the map. You can also use your collision hitbox to make a blight slide off an object that they were planning to bump, such as a tree or a wall. This will often leave the blight going into fatigue, but there's a chance that you can still bump into something else, so do keep that in mind. I want to quickly mention lockers. I strongly suggest not using a locker to dodge a hit if you are fully healed. The only exception is if the blight is running iridescent tag, which is more important for you to get injured than for you to get fully downed. If you are going to get downed anyways, dodging a hit by going to a locker can save you a few extra seconds, and if a pallet's nearby, you might be able to make it to the pallet before his fatigue is over. Lockers can be pretty helpful in preventing the blight from snowballing. If you're being chased nearby another survivor and you're injured, you can jump into a locker and force them to either pick you up or leave you in the locker to chase your teammates. Then we're going to quickly mention check spots and his directional audio. Check spots refer to areas where you can stand and get the best possible view to be able to look in both directions and depict on which way the killer is coming. For Blight, his most optimal check spots are a lot different compared to normal M1 killers, which is why I feel like a lot of survivors struggle against the Blight. This Blight is so fast, so being on the opposite end of the loop often will not work, as he will catch up to you before you can make it to the pallet. One useful thing to keep in mind is being able to hear the rushes and bumps through the walls.
Yeah.
If you hear the blight bumping multiple times in quick succession, they're most likely attempting a hug check. You can also hear which direction the blight is going in, which allows you to react early before the blight can even see you. Having really unique pathing when inside jungle gyms, making it hard for the blight to predict where you're going, while waiting at different corners and listening to where the blight currently is. So that's all I have for you today. I do want to quickly mention that blight is a killer that takes not only a long time to play as, but to play against. When it comes to playing as and against the blight, it's something that can't be done in one day. Since blight is a very unique and complex killer, it takes both sides a very long time to learn his counterplay and how to play as him. Well, that's all I have for you guys. This video took a very long time to make. It's probably been about 4 or 5 months since the starting of this recording, so I would really appreciate it if you guys could drop a like and subscribe. Huge shout out for some of my friends, Kai and Benjo, which will be down in the description below, and a few other friends such as David and Jacob. You guys are awesome. I appreciate you guys. But yeah, that's all I have for you. You have a great night, and I'll see y'all later.